Welcome to the town board meeting for Thursday, June 26, 2014. Please rise and salute the flag.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to have a moment of silence for Richard Stearns, who's a past employee of the town of Amenia for 22 years and served as highway foreman, who died in a tragic accident near Glens Falls, New York this week. And also for our brave troops and all our local, several of our local people who have passed away in the last few months. Emergency exits are to my right, the door behind the town clerk, and also the door that you came in. Roll, please.
Councilman Delango?
Here.
Councilwoman Hetzelberger?
Here.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Here.
Councilman Perotti?
Present.
And Supervisor Perotti?
Here. Public comment?
We have Michael Collins.
Michael Collins, Amenia. I guess the first, a little shout out to Leo Blackman and company for the plantings they did outside. It's very nice out there. That being said, the trees that were planted last year along the sidewalk are already in your face. You can't walk side by side down the street without running into the trees that were planted, several of them. But anyway, we've lived in Amenia for more than 10 years now. Several times I've voiced my concerns to the town board regarding quality of life issues. Little, if anything, has ever been addressed. Because I rarely see any of you walk through the village, I understand that these concerns must be brought to your attention. For example, why would the town allow truckloads of garbage and debris fill the stream near the basketball courts? When we brought the garbage to the curb, we brought it to your attention. Or how could the town allow potentially dangerous cracked plate glass windows go unchecked for years? Not windows off the beaten path or down some alley, but right in the center of town, a short distance from the post office and a step or two from the street. I brought it to your attention last year, along with other quality of life issues associated with the same building. I brought this obvious fact to your attention, along with a letter to the editor. It is my understanding that our code enforcer had to order the co-owner, planning board member Tony Robustelli, to make the necessary repairs. There is something fundamentally wrong with that. However, it only gets worse. With a quick glance through the planning board minutes, you will find what I believe to be comments that could easily be construed as conflicts of interest. If you had looked at the town records in January, you would have found that there were no permits issued for multiple signs located at another property that planning board member Tony Robustelli co-owns. But it gets worse. Despite this being a very small town, you had no idea that a planning board member and convenience store owner commented about Cumberland Farms, or who has permits for what signs. This information was read to you in January. Paper copies were provided to you in January. Paper copies of minutes copied and pasted from the town website. A paper copy of a FOIL request that stated there were no permits for multiple signs. All of that information that I provided came from right here under your noses in the town hall. Again, you were made fully aware of these legitimate concerns. I requested that you take immediate action. You did absolutely nothing. That is fundamentally wrong and only poses more questions. So please listen carefully. Is it fair to residents of Amenia if a planning board member does not comply with zoning laws. Stephen?
You're asking me?
I'm asking you.
You don't have to answer. We're going to discuss that.
Why wouldn't he have to answer it? I'm asking for his opinion. Is it fair to residents of Amenia if a planning board member does not comply with zoning laws?
Of all the zoning complaints that you had, I believe Mr. Fenton answered them.
I'm sorry?
I believe Mr. Fenton answered the complaints that you had regarding zoning.
No, he
signs.
Didn't. No, he didn't. And I'm asking you now.
Yes,
I'm
he did.
I'm asking you if...
I have a copy of the email where he answered you when you foiled and he gave you information.
He never emailed me.
No, he emailed me what he gave to
you. And you never provided me with information.
Who?
Who what?
I'm not going to argue this with you.
Okay, but can I have
your
opinion?
Under,
is it fair to residents of Amenia if a planning board member does not comply with zoning laws? Do you want somebody, anybody, to be a planning board member if they're not going to comply with the zoning laws? Is it fair to the residents of Amenia? I'm just asking a question. Is it fair to the residents of Amenia if you have a planning board member that does not comply with the zoning laws that he's making determinations that other people must comply with? Do you believe that's fair?
If it's true, but I don't know that it's true. I have
You with all that information.
You provided me with a lot of conjecture.
Is it okay? Well, it was obtained from the town. That's what I didn't provide you with my opinion. I provided
I'm
you with
gonna
records.
I'm not going to argue the case with you tonight.
Okay, you don't have to argue it, but I provided you with records from the town, not my opinion. Is it fair if a planning board member comments regarding issues related to a business in direct competition with his own? Any of you? Gretchen?
I would think that there are certain cases where members of any board would want to recuse themselves from the conversation.
Right, I agree. Is it fair that a planning board member requests the town, meaning taxpayer, to do something for current or former business partner? Is that a fair thing to do?
It seems to me that you have like an ethics complaint regarding one of the planning board members.
I've spoke
have,
to
have
previous planning
board complaint?
I've spoken to previous planning board members and current planning board members, and they said go to the town board.
If you believe that there is an ethics problem with one of our planning board members, then I would submit
No, I went above
complaint.
It, Stephen.
No, we need to...
And
town
I prevented you with the information
me, I'm speaking.
Back in January, and this information you could have easily provided to the ethics board. If that's the... If you wanted to throw it to them before they threw it back to you, that would have been a very
they
easy
thing
to do. They don't
throw it back to us. They give us an advisory
exactly.
opinion.
Exactly. But I thought you'd be able to make your own simple determination regarding that. Mike?
Are there any other violations that you see around town besides the ones from the certain planning board member?
I could probably come up with many.
I mean, it...
The building that I'm talking about has been a quality of life issue for nearly as long as we've been here.
Mike, but like I said, we could split hairs and we could pick a lot of stuff out in the town. What about the building that's next to that? You understand what
I'm
saying?
I've never had a quality of life issue with it.
So
it doesn't affect me, Mike.
But
you
what do you mean by a quality
that,
of life issue? That's what I don't understand. I mean, and I'm not trying to split hairs with you, Mike. I mean,
broken plate glass windows that are possibly dangerous.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you a quick story about several years ago. The tenants that were living in that building, a mother, several young kids. We had just been here a couple of years. We're sitting out on our deck enjoying a little dinner. And the three of them walk by, and the mother says the F word three times. I have two young children sitting with me as they pass by our sidewalk and cross the driveway. Three times, a matter of 50 feet. I'm like, well, it looks like maybe we can't sit down on the deck unless we want to subject our children to this.
Okay?
Your dad was renting space in that building when a car hit it.
I know.
The car knocked off the handrail, the handicapped handrail that was installed for Mike's dad, and knocked off part of the facade. You people have been talking about facade committee stuff for 10 years and how we're gonna do all these improvements. And that sat there unrepaired for over a year. The handrail was hanging down, parts of the facade were pushed back. And then, you know what, it's not just Joe Citizen, it's a planning board member. This person, I believe, should not be making decisions regarding other people's property.
Again, Mike, I do agree with you with the issues, but again, are we singling...
Then why wasn't something done, Mike?
Aren't we singling out one person? This is what it is. Is this turning into a vendetta?
At this point, yes.
I mean, this is what it comes down to. I mean, if we're looking for quality of life and we're looking to help the town and we're looking to make the town a better place, let's get all the issues together and let's figure out everything. Instead of singling out one person.
Let's start at the top and say, listen, this person's making determinations or helping make determinations regarding other people's property. If it was somebody else, I could complain about several buildings, believe me, but those people are not making determinations regarding other people's property.
But it still affects the quality of life.
Not to the extent that this building has.
Okay. I mean, I do understand what you're saying, and I do agree that you have the heart of the town at it and everything else. But again, singling out one person, right or wrong, I think we should get all the zoning issues together that we have in town, try to fix them in a timely manner, and try to go about it systematically, rather than just trying to crucify one person.
You're just repeating yourself. I'm not trying to crucify one person.
You know, and as far as looking at the planning board, in general, and in the past, you know, I think this kind of goes beyond just one person. When you have real estate brokers that serve on the planning board and then utilize their position for their own purposes, you know,
exactly.
That is wrong. And as I used to have my license for, I had my license for almost 20 years, and I can say, from an ethical standpoint, if you're a real estate broker and you have a potential interest in making some money on a transaction in the town, you should be recusing yourself.
Yeah, you should have a higher standard.
I would recuse myself.
Okay, at this point, we do have a 5-minute limit for public comment.
Okay.
And
well,
you're
I voiced
at that
legitimate
limit.
Concerns
yes,
back
you
in January, and I never even got a response. I was completely ignored. Legitimate concerns were repeatedly dismissed, and now I want to know why.
And
why did I come up here for nothing? And what are you going to do about it?
I believe all of your concerns were brought to the code enforcement officer. And
that's
he addressed
true.
Them.
That's not true.
Yeah, well, you had pictures
clueless.
And pictures were given to him.
That was prior. That was last year. That was not January. That was regarding his cracked plate glass windows and everything. I said nothing about that in January. Like I said, you were absolutely clueless when I spoke to you in March regarding what I had presented to you and handed you town documents that after addressing it last year and showing you photos of these broken plate glass windows could be a danger to anybody. This person's making decisions regarding other people's property. Look at his own. That's not right.
Well, we will be discussing it at a board and taking what we feel is appropriate action, and that's all we're going to say
last
about
Thursday,
it
last Thursday, you
night.
Told me you were going to do that. You told me you were going to do an executive session that night. Friday morning, you were very rude about it. You said you did not discuss it. You turned your back and walked away from it.
Yes, I did, because I explained to you I had something else we
you
were covering.
You explained to me the day before
I do
that
not
you were
going to
address
to,
it.
I do not have to account to you for what we discussed in executive
in
session.
This town, and my
yes, you
of life
certainly are, and I think you need to sit down now.
Okay. One last thing. There was recently a fire at Tony Robustelli's other property over here. Okay? And from what I could gather looking at the town records, he has not had a fire inspection since 2009. Please look into it.
Is there any other public comment?
Thank
yes, we have two additional.
Michael.
Good evening, everybody. Mike Chisholm came with the Housatonic Valley Association. I'm trying to take up too much of your time. So I wanted to come and update the board on the 10 Mile Watershed Forum that HVA put on a couple Saturdays back. It was Saturday, June 7th. We got this forum together because, as some of you are probably aware, the 10 Mile Watershed is at a little bit of a disadvantage when it comes to bringing in resources to do watershed management. It's the land area of the watershed is primarily within New York State, but the river flows into Connecticut. So there's some jurisdictional issues there that make it difficult to access some of the programs that are out there to do things like watershed planning, stream management, those types of things. So the idea was to try and bring watershed communities and other stakeholders together and start looking towards some things we can do to maybe speak with a unified voice and try to work together to bring more resources into the watershed to deal with some of these problems that are really watershed scale issues. Like flooding is a problem that transcends town boundaries. Water quality is a problem that transcends town boundaries. So we got a lot of good information at the forum. We had a lot of excellent speakers, and we also had great participation from across the watershed. There were people from every community there, including Amenia. Vicki was there, and was there anybody else?
Dave Reagan, our CAC chair, was there.
Mm-hmm.
We had Tom Werner, I believe, and we had about three people, Sharon Kroger, Citizens,
yeah.
Tonya, obviously, who ran the program. We were well represented for
yes.
Amenia.
And which is great, because if you look at the map, you can see that, you know, Amenia is right there at the heart
yeah.
of the watershed.
Right.
So really the conversation about watershed planning and management ought to start here in Amenia. So we heard about some things, the potential opportunities for going forward, one of which is the Department of State's watershed planning programs. And we heard from Barbara Kendall and Tracy O'Malley from the Department of State Watershed Program. And in order to be eligible for, they have five or six different programs that deal with watershed planning and implementation. In order to be eligible for those, you have to be on the state's list of designated inland water bodies, and there's a process to that. The first step really is having all the communities in the watershed do some sort of expression of support for going through that process. So that's one of the reasons why I'm here tonight, is to talk with you a little bit more about, as we go forward, getting some sort of expression of support for that process, which is really getting a whole bunch of letters from all the communities in the watershed and talking with our legislators and enacting the state legislature to get on that list. And again, once we're on that list, there's a whole bunch of programs that open up for watershed management. So, you know, and the purpose of tonight is really just to give you a brief rundown of what happened at the forum. So I don't want to take up too much more of your time, but I'm definitely willing to come back and talk in a little bit more detail about some of the things we learned and some of the opportunities for going forward. And I can certainly answer any questions that you have.
I do have one question.
Sure.
I was reading with interest how well-funded the watershed, the Wappingers Creek watershed, is getting. All kinds of communities are getting
yes.
All kinds of support to improve areas that have chronic flooding issues. When we're having these episodic rainfalls, they had all kinds of communities were able to rectify those with sizable grants. And I know that Town of Amenia does have areas that have problems with flooding. The Willows, for instance, has a chronic issue on Route 343. So by asking for the legislature to include the 10-mile watershed, that would be the kind of assistance that you envision?
Yes, so
is that true?
The Wappingers watershed just went through that same process, and that's why they're
can you
to
go
that
back
process.
To the I'm sorry, thank you.
Not a big fan of podiums. The Wappingers watershed just went through that same process, and that's why they're eligible for the
all
the
of a sudden. I just saw article after article after article saying we're solving this chronic issue
mm-hmm.
that really needed some long-term solutions,
right? And
right.
you know, there's a reason that those programs are aimed at watersheds and not just communities. It's because these problems are, they need to be addressed at a watershed scale, because the solution to a problem, if that's in Amenia, it may be upstream in Northeast. And without working together at that level, it's very difficult to address some of these issues. So that's the reason why they want to see that watershed-wide cooperation before you can really get in the door for these programs. So again, I'm more than willing to continue to work with the town Amenia and also all the other communities in the watershed to work on this listing process. And I could come back certainly, as soon as you guys would like me to talk more about what's, sort of the nuts and bolts of the next step.
Okay.
you guys.
Well, it sounded to me like the next step would be to request our watershed communities to be eligible for this funding, right?
So,
to be added to that list. So we need to write a letter, obviously, to our officials,
exactly.
Our state officials,
yep.
Asking, because there's just a gap. I mean, unless you request specific inclusion, you are not eligible. So there are very specific communities that
now, who would the letter need to be go to in particular?
I believe it would be to your legislative representatives.
Both our Assemblywoman,
yes.
Dee Dee Barrett, and our
yes.
State Senator Gibson, Terry Gibson.
But we can definitely get back to you with all of that information and certainly some model language for that kind of a letter.
Yeah, that's what I would like to see is a model.
Yep.
Model letter. And if the board will make a motion to authorize me to send a letter to our legislative body.
I would like to make second that motion.
Well, could you make
that motion? I'll make that motion.
For
requesting inclusion into the list of eligible communities for funding for
yeah, it's
watershed.
Actually the eligible inland waterways. So it's asking for the 10 mile to be listed as an inland waterway.
And that would include our tributaries that
the whole yeah, right. It would cover the.
Right.
I think we would probably want to list the major ones by name. And again, I can come back with some model language. And the other great thing that we have is we've got the Wappingers Watershed that just went through this process, and they have a lot of resources
right.
we can draw on there.
Okay.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilman Perotti?
Yes.
Supervisor Perotti?
Yes. Well, thank you for coming and sharing the information, and we hope to see you again and
yeah.
You know, with any updates.
We'll keep the conversation going, and I also brought you guys a larger version of this map. I'll leave it for you. I'll leave it right here for you.
Could you please give it to the town clerk?
Sure.
Now you can move the podium.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's a great map.
Is there any other public comments?
Yes, we have Tom Warner.
Hey, Tom.
Thank you, Tom Warner from Amenia. If I could, through the chair, could I ask our attorney a question? I'm asking her the legal description of recluse.
Recuse?
Recusing yourself from a decision, is that what you're saying?
I know what I was taught, and it seems to be a little different.
Of someone recusing yourself from a vote.
In other words, someone is excusing themselves from participating in voting or making decisions on a certain matter because they have some type of a conflict of interest that might cause them to be biased in one way or another.
When you relinquish your chair under those conditions, do you not leave?
No, you just...
You mean as a board member?
Whatever.
Okay.
If you're not going to vote on an issue,
Do they have to leave the room? If someone is on a board and has to recuse themselves, I mean, I would believe they could just sit in the audience. I mean,
yeah,
they don't necessarily have to leave the room.
Normally, I think people don't leave the room, you know, if it were
But
a
then
matter.
They can get right back up and go sit down in that chair and continue.
Could you still be involved in the discussion? You just can't vote.
Well, I don't know that it would be appropriate to participate in the discussion.
Depends on the level.
Yeah. Might be able to sway other board members based on your interests. So I would not be participating. If it was me, I wouldn't participate in the discussion.
Right.
Okay, when you got 14 answers already.
No, you have one. She said...
No, we're saying that if you have a conflict of interest, then you shouldn't be participating in the discussion and having input toward the ultimate decision that's made. Are you asking about leaving the room? I don't think you would be required to leave the room. I mean, personally, I think if there were a matter being addressed, and I were a member of a board and perhaps it concerned, let's say, my own issue, I probably would, but I'm not saying that you would have to.
I realize that, and I'm not trying to push or get into a squabble. I just want to know one set of rules that we follow.
Well, I mean, I don't know what circumstance you're addressing in particular.
Any of our laws that we have, you're supposed to preclude yourself should there be a conflict of interest or even a mention that it may be, it doesn't have to be a total issue where you are involved or have been found to be involved.
Well, I think if you're involved, you would have an actual conflict of interest.
Right. And but the laws, most of them say if there was an issue that might be a conflict of interest, you could be asked to reclude yourself as well.
No, I mean, I think you have to determine, is there an actual conflict of interest before the person would have to decide should he or she recuse themselves?
All right, well, I'll bring one of the laws in and you can look at that. Thank you.
Is there any other public comment?
No one else signed up, but...
Town clerk report.
Good evening. The minutes of June 12th and 19th have been circulated among the board. At the 19th meeting, which was not televised, one of the items that was discussed was the resignation of Jim Walsh from the planning board. So I'd like to announce that the town of Amenia is seeking applications for the volunteer position of planning board. I've also added workforce housing board to the announcement. Town residency is required. Letters of interest may be submitted via email to townclerk@ameniany.gov or via mail to the town clerk at 4988 Route 22, Amenia, New York. The deadline applications is noon, July 9th. So if anyone's interested in participating on either board, please submit your application and letter of interest. And on some exciting news. This weekend is free fishing days. So June 28th and June 29th, everyone can enjoy freshwater fishing or marine water fishing. There's no license required. So if that's something that an adult has been wanting to do and doesn't have their license, you can still get out there and fish this weekend. Do you want me to bring up the gathering permit?
Yes, please.
We've received a request from John Fountain, the building inspector. The Amenia Fire Company has come forward to obtain a public gathering permit for the 2014 annual carnival with fireworks, and the event is to take place July 2nd through July 5th. They are requesting that the fee for the gathering permit be waived for this event as it has in the past. If anybody has any questions, contact John Fountain. So
I'll make a motion to waive the fee for the gathering permit for the 2014 annual Amenia Fireman Carnival that's to take place between July 2nd, 2014 through July 5th, 2014.
I'll second that. Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Yes.
Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilman Perotti?
Yes.
And Supervisor Perotti?
Yes.
And that's all I have this evening. Thank you.
Highway Department?
Yeah, we've been pretty busy. We've been installing curtain drains or under drains on these dirt roads, places that get muddy every year. We've tried many things. Like on Tower Hill, we worked on Tower Hill yesterday, and we have filter fabric, a foot of bank run, still gets muddy. So we tore it up yesterday, and we went down like 3.5 feet. We hit some springs. It's pretty dry out there right now, so we piped it off over the bank. So hopefully that helps us a lot. We did some tree cutting on Mygat, took down a couple dead trees. That's about all I have. Any questions?
Get the new excavator yet?
Yeah, we got the new excavator. Yeah, we've been working it.
How's it been working? Good?
Good. Excellent. Yep. Yep.
Is there, did you have a chance to look at the bank on that has been undermined on Old Route 22, apparently? That was part of the CAC report that Victoria said that you were going to look into Old Route 22.
Oh, the it's
the
it isn't. It actually wasn't. Yeah, it was County Route 81.
That's a county road.
So you don't. That's
no.
Not
I have nothing to do with
issue.
That.
Okay.
I know what they're talking about. That's been washed off for years.
Yep. You think it's eminently needs to be looked at by the county?
Oh, I haven't seen it in years.
Oh.
And when the gravel bank was operating.
Right.
I've
changed.
Never seen it.
Yeah.
But I haven't been down there in 15 years or more.
So that issue needs to go to the county.
Anything else? That's it.
Thanks, ma'am.
Building department report?
I didn't have anything.
Okay. Water district report? Don't have one. Grant report?
Great, thanks, Mike.
Passing out the grant update. It's been a busy month, I would say. On the positive front, the Main Street grant has been completed. We had an audit from Aaron Kinney of the New York State Office of Community Renewal a couple weeks ago. I've given her what she wanted in terms of some follow-up. There was no findings. The grant was actually done in an expeditious manner. We had a very productive meeting with her. There's a very detailed file on the whole grant upstairs that we've kept here so that if there are any questions in the future, if there's ever an audit, it's all there. All the disbursement requests, the original grant application, a full accounting of the grant, all the details. Because the town has been fully reimbursed, there was $195,000. There is still $1,000 left. That's one question. We may not be able to recover that because the town has spent the money. I'll ask Aaron Kinney if you do want to do that. We may be able to amend the budget because this was a grant that involved basically building renovations. That's what Main Street grants are supposed to do, and we did accomplish that by renovating three buildings in the downtown district for 100.
Yeah, we were going to check to see if we could use that additional money towards streetscape because we spent more than the $25,000 that was in the grant amount. So I think she mentioned somewhere along the line we might be able to do that. So we need to follow up with her to
Which
see
I
if
will.
We can get the additional $1,000.
Yes, but we were reimbursed $25,000. The total project for streetscape was $40,000 approximately. So and the $25,000 was actually at the time the maximum amount that the town could get for a streetscape component of the Main Street project. So I think that is also positive. Plus we also were reimbursed $10,000 for the grant administration time, which has resulted in a $35,000, after all the bills were paid, $35,000 in the Main Street bank account. So that was closed. We had a good meeting with her, and also we applied to the consolidated funding application for the sidewalk project in downtown Amenia. Pete Sotero gave us a really nice cost estimate and a map of the proposed new sidewalk. It would really be rebuilding approximately 800 feet of current walkway from downtown to Broadway and building 350 feet of new sidewalk to the park. And we applied for two grants under Market New York and under Empire State Development Funds, which in the end were the two best prospects for the town in doing the consolidated funding application. We are asking for $181,000. The total project cost is $242,000, but that includes legal, engineering fees, contingencies, and construction and landscaping. So it really would be a great project if it could be financed. It was a very detailed grant. I have a copy of it. One of them, we did get a lot of good letters of support from all of our elected state officials and from our Congressman Chris Gibson, and also from Claire Houlihan, who would benefit from this grant too, because it would involve repairing that area in front of the site, in front of the post office, that needs some attention. It's not.
Yeah, Senator Gibson wrote a very good letter.
Actually, could I read some of that? Because I printed it up.
His,
there was a not, his, it kind of gave
much,
us a lot of.
Yeah, he pretty much pointed out that we're the forgotten part of Dutchess County.
I think in all his visits to the Harlem Valley, this must have been a message that came from this, because I did give him a sample letter, which he incorporated in this, and he was saying how I applaud the town's efforts to obtain grant funding for community walkways and believe new sidewalks can provide for improved public safety. In Amenia, an improved sidewalk network will support regional tourism efforts by making it more convenient to walk around and become familiar with Amenia and its outdoor recreation opportunities. Sidewalks also have potential to improve the business climate, enhance a community's appearance, reduce crime, and promote public health. In recent decades, the Harlem Valley has sometimes been overlooked when it comes to state economic development efforts. Here we have an opportunity to make that right. I hope the town is successful in obtaining these much needed grant funds and building momentum for continued downtown revitalization. Senator Terry Gibson. So, and he wrote it right to Dennis Murray, the co-chair of the Mid-Hudson Regional Economic Development Council. And we did apply, got it in ahead of the deadline, actually, and got these good letters of support, so I'm hoping we'll be successful. But we do have a good proposal to build on.
Yeah, when we went to the consolidated funding application meeting, they one of the things they stressed is to have the letters of support. It really, you know, strengthens your grant application. And we had four very strong letters, three from representatives and one from a local business person.
So we've been focusing on closing out our existing grants and fine-tuning the kitchen grant. I've met with Rudy as recently as tonight. We also met with George Pop of USDA Rural Development. We're trying to get a community facilities grant that would help support the kitchen. And in working on this grant, we have submitted a lot of financial information about the town of Amenia and have done an analysis of the town's long-term debts, and looking at us qualifying for a grant from them because they're very competitive, and he was a little bit on the pessimistic side, but we have not heard back from him in terms of, he was gonna try to see if the town may not be eligible for a grant because you really don't have, right now on paper, a lot of long-term debt. However, in meeting with him, in talking about the town's socioeconomic profile, it was agreed that Amenia is a low-income community. So we've already cleared some hurdles that are part of this grant.
They want us to have more debt?
Having more debt in a way, yes. But we were saying about the Amenia landfill and some of the liabilities.
Well, we gave, the potential debt for the old Amenia
right.
landfill.
There's plenty of potential debt.
So he, I'm sure that'll be taken into consideration.
Right. But it is an interesting exercise because we can find loan rate. I mean, you probably wouldn't want to just get a loan from the USDA. We want a grant. But one of the things I do want to do, because we did get a letter from our congressman, and at the end of his letter of support, he wants to know the status of this grant. So I am going to keep reminding George that it is important to our congressman. And it is, in talking to Rudy, this could actually be, it won't be a drag on the town's budget if it's done correctly, because it could actually produce some revenue by having, even if you charged a minimal amount per hour and you had six vendors using it twice a week, you have potential to generate up to $6,000 a year, which could help support, you know, maintenance costs. So we're putting together a budget for
rental fees?
Just considering that, like operating the kitchen.
Yeah, we also had very good letters of support. Senator Gibson serves on the Agriculture Committee, and Representative Gibson serves on the Agriculture Committee, and they were both very supportive of the kitchen grant and wrote, you know, very strong letters for us of support.
Yes. So.
But we can only hope.
Right. But we do have some grants still on the books that need to be worked on too, such as the, we've been given notice by Dutchess County that they would like us to respond regarding the Wasaic Trail to the Train grant.
Well, actually I called and asked and set up the meeting.
Oh, yes.
They didn't give us notice. I called and asked her for a meeting to sit down and discuss an extension for the grant.
Okay.
Based on the fact that it's taken so long to get through the DC, the DEC, Metro North, and we're changing some language in the documents for the right-of-way documents for the owner of the land who wants to change the verbiage in the right-of-way documents from easement to donation, as he wants to donate the land that for the Trail of the Train to the town. So we're working on the, you know, the actual wording for that.
Sorry, so it would be an outright donation of the land or
yes.
a donation of the easement? So they want to add?
No, there won't be an easement.
So they're donating the land?
Yes.
Okay.
They want to give, he wants to give the land to the town. So we need to, you know, we use standard right-of-way documents that are usually used for federal grants, so we just need to change some of the language and then, you know, for him to sign it.
Well, hopefully we'll be successful in maintaining the existing grants from community development and from the Dormitory Authority.
Mm-hmm. I would just mention that the OCFS, the Office of Children and Family Services for the dance program, is $1,200 this year, not the $470 that we got in the past.
Oh, I will update so that. I meant to ask you about that. I did
want
to
fine.
Get an update.
It was a competitive process this year, and they awarded what they award. So
is the other one still true, the Berkshire Taconic?
That one's fine. 2000? The $2,000 is correct.
So you have $3,200 in grants?
And I have $250 in a private donation.
All right. I'll include that in the next one.
Actually, I wanted to bring up something from the building department. We had received a request from John Fenton, a code enforcement officer, from a letter from June 4th requesting that the board allow for the bid of a third-party lawn maintenance company to cut weeds and grass at two addresses in Wasaic. And after he sent them a order to remedy, that they went ahead and cleaned the property themselves. So we did not have to go out to bid to pay for cleaning the two properties at 14 Main Street and 18 Furnace Bank Road. So we didn't have to do that.
What about the other four properties that we're currently seeking?
He didn't, we don't, there, we don't have anything on the four properties. He hasn't given us a list. The next, he's working on a current list. He's been going around town and looking at all the properties that are currently overgrown, and we'll be getting a new list. But I, you know, I just wanted to point out that we did not have to get a bid because the, whoever the property owners were took care of the problem themselves. So we didn't have to do that.
Just then as a follow-up, so the board's aware, Sue did make phone calls to six companies,
mm-hmm.
knowing that they needed to get bids, and she had the four addresses. There's four addresses currently that was given to her.
I don't know.
Just so that if you guys hear it around town, that's what's going on.
Well, we'll be given that information for another meeting. But we, you know, he just requests to get bid for these two properties. But I think for him to go ahead and get bids from different companies before he presents us the property is
good idea.
Is a good idea. Then we can get them cleaned up faster. Any other committee reports?
I'll give the CAC if that's an appropriate time. Dear town board members, I had two. This is from Dave Reagan, chairman of the CAC. And they met, and we met last week at our normal third Wednesday at 7 o'clock. And Victoria Perotti asked for a report to the town board, which they received. And I'll read the summary of the gist of that particular part of the meeting. I had two meetings last week with Dominic Peaver, and the owner of Washed Aggregates, which is a gravel mine located just north of the hamlet of Wasaic off of County Route 81. The meetings were arranged by Housatonic Valley Association's local director, Tonya Shimatoff, and held at her office in Wasaic. During these meetings, which included two site visits, Mr. Peaver uncovered a number of problems that exist on the three parcels that Washed Aggregate owns, and he produced copies of written materials, maps, and pictures that go back over 25 years. The most relevant issues that I want to call your attention to are as follows. The case of the missing barrels. Mr. Peaver claims, and he has pictures, that there were 55-gallon barrels containing waste oil near the crushing plant. These barrels were leaking onto the ground, and Mr. Peaver made an attempt to convince his business partners to pay to have the situation remedied. Estimates for removing oil by a licensed waste hauler were well over $25,000, and the partners balked at this. Mr. Peaver claims that the partners hired someone to dispose of the barrels and their contents for less than $700, and he has records that support this claim. The fate of the barrels and their contents is an open question. They may have been dumped on the site and buried. This matter is now under investigation by the New York State DEC as a criminal act. John Fenton was advised of the presence of leaking barrels on 11/29/2012. Number two, the case of the large dumping ground. Mr. Peaver showed me a large dump that he claimed was mostly on MTA land, but appears to me from looking at the Dutchess County parcel access maps to be mostly on his land. This dump, which is close to the Amenia stream floodplain, is located just north of the gravel bank and just west of County Route 81. It consists of a large mass of tires, garbage, 55-gallon drums, and a lot of large pieces of metal. Nearly all of it is covered with dense vegetation, which makes walking in the area very difficult. It's also infested with insects. Because of the vegetation, it is very hard to estimate the size of the dump. Examination of aerial photos taken over several years show that the dump was active for a very long time and it's been dormant for several years. A smaller dump nearby consists of partially buried 5-gallon containers that are filled with some substance. DEC is aware of this smaller deposit. Number three, the case of the unreclaimed gravel mine. The mine itself probably does not have an active permit from DEC. It's not in the soil mining overlay district and it does not currently have an exit. There is a lot of machinery on the property, as well as several trailers and partially raised structures. Mr. Peaver claims that a lot of valuable equipment has been stolen from the property. Currently, there's no security, and the property is easily accessible from both County Route 81 and the Metro North Wasaic Station. A serious washout has occurred on the property in the berm that divides the gravel bank from Route 81. A car or pedestrian could easily fall several feet into the mine from the roadway. Number four, the case of the North Farm. The northern part of the property is known as the North Farm. There is a zoning issue currently on this property that Mr. Fenton is aware of and has advised Mr. Peaver of. A construction and demolition dump is also present on this site and is located on the floodplain. Remediation for this dump was sought by Charles Back, the zoning officer, in 1988, but it remains unremediated, as do several other Amenia sites from that period. On our site visit, Mr. Peaver showed me some evidence of dumping on another part of the property. This smaller site seemed to consist of at least two 55-gallon drums. Mr. Peaver states openly that he wants the site cleaned up and made safe. He is in litigation with his partners, and he claims he himself is bankrupt. There are many legal issues on this site, and it is a real can of worms. That said, there are serious threats to surface and groundwater that exist here. The CAC discussed this at our last meeting. I have pictures that I took during the first site visit that I will attach. Thank you for your attention to the serious problem. Dave Reagan, Chair, Conservation Advisory Commission. So we certainly discussed more than that, but that seems to have raised to the attention of the town board. We also, the agenda was as follows: the Wasaic Park and improvements that we've made to that, with vegetation and the proposed Boy Scout improvements to the kiosk, Silo Ridge and the planning board, washed aggregate, which I just reported on, and filings, requests, and complaints. That was our report.
Vicki, is that the same gentleman who was here last December?
Yes.
And he said that he doesn't have any violations on that property?
He doesn't have any what?
There's no, he said, we don't have violations, so I should get my money back from my partners.
He said a lot of things. He said about 30 minutes worth of very hard to follow logic. And I commend Dave Reagan for sorting out a lot of the details.
Dave did a very good job.
He had a file this thick that he was trying to show to Dave. So he brought out the salient points, the actual facts that he could verify, and laid them out for the town board. So I can't tell you what he said in his...
Did he notify the county about the issue with the road?
I don't know. It doesn't say that in Dave's report.
If it's a safety issue, wouldn't that be something the CAC would call the county and tell them about?
Let's just read what he says about that. As our highway department mentioned, that hasn't changed in years, probably 15 years. So I assume that...
Maybe it's time we brought it to the county's attention.
Currently, there's no security in property. A serious washout has occurred on the property in the berm that divides the gravel bank from Route 81. I stand corrected. It could be that washout happened earlier. A car or pedestrian could easily fall several feet into the mine from the roadway. I think it would be more impact to have our supervisor ask for assistance from the county.
Yeah. Wow.
When I got this information, I forwarded it to our attorney and John Fenton. And I believe, Denise, you're meeting tomorrow with John to go over the file.
Yes. I mean, I've drafted the initial letter, but I want to look through the file
to
see what the history is.
I asked our attorney to draft a letter to the DEC to see what their status is on this particular property. I mean, whether they've looked at it, whether, you know, there's anything we need to do. I think we need to be proactive with this and send them a letter and tell them, you know, this is what we're concerned and, you know, where do we go from here?
I don't understand the point of the meetings, though. I mean, he says he wants to take care of the problems. Take care of them. I guess, is he asking from help for the town?
No.
Is that what it's coming down to?
Sounds to me like he's trying to...
I'm not sure what he's doing. He's, has come to town board meetings and, you know, brought different issues about his personal problems. He's been in litigation with Metro North. He's currently in litigation with his partners. I mean, he has a lot of personal issues with that. That aside, I mean, that's his problem. What I want to know if is any part of this is our problem, which is why we're going to send a letter to the DEC and say, is there something here that the town is responsible for, and, you know, what do we need to do? And I think that's the safest route for us to follow right now. So, we do have our own file from, from our dealings with Mr. Peaburn, and that's what Denise and John are going to review tomorrow.
Right. And then we can see what DEC has, whether there's an outstanding mining permit with a reclamation plan, and whether there are things they should have done under the reclamation plan that they have not completed.
There's what's really unknown here is what the DEC has, what they've looked at, what they haven't, you know, what they have. So that's what we need to know. And, you know, I think us going directly to the DEC is the best way to proceed.
But if there's some danger on the county route and you speak with the county, you know, possibly the county would come out and put up some kind of a guard along the edge of the road at least, you know, to prevent a hazard to motorists or even pedestrians.
Yeah, I'm going to call them tomorrow.
Address,
what address?
81.
The parcel is right next to Metro North train station, just south. If you would go to the back of the Wasaac train station's parking lot,
okay,
and drive onto the little bridge that's now out of use, that would connect you directly to that large parcel that is between the Wasaac train station. You know, it's got old
the
equipment.
The old Allen property?
It's the old, the Allen property, but near
further
there,
south.
But further south.
South of Metro.
It's an old mine. It's the old Peaburn mine.
I know where the bridge is that we used to walk across.
Okay. Just keep walking. It's contiguous with...
Okay, from 81, I was thinking of the overpass.
No.
Because that's the only strip of it that I knew.
Are there any other committee reports? Okay, currently we're, per our zoning regulations, we are working on a local law for fee in lieu of workforce housing for not only Silo Ridge, but also any other projects that will come before us in the future. Denise,
do we have a copy of that?
I gave it to you.
Well,
we don't have a copy of, we haven't done the law yet. You don't have a copy of it because what we want to do is discuss some of the language that needs to be put in the proposed law.
I mean, I think it's important to actually look at the provision in the zoning law for the workforce housing, section 121-42, and subsection N provides that the town board may establish by separate local law a fee to be paid into a dedicated town workforce housing trust fund as an alternative to the construction of workforce housing where such housing is either mandated or available as a condition of a density bonus. The amount of such fee shall be determined in the local law authorizing the fee and shall be sufficient to cover the net cost of creating new workforce housing units, considering land acquisition, planning, design, construction, and administrative costs, offset by the anticipated sale price or present value of rental income to be derived from the sale or rental of such unit at below market rates. So that's the section that authorizes the town board to set a fee, if it so chooses, by a separate local law. Another section I think the board should pay particular attention to is subsection L, which is administration. It states the town board shall appoint a housing board, which it has previously done, which shall administer the workforce housing program. The town board may also hire staff or contract with Dutchess County or a qualified not-for-profit organization, government agency, or private consultant to administer all or a portion of the workforce housing program under the direction and oversight of the housing board. That's a particular phrase that I think we need to think about in drafting the law as to who's going to administer and make the decisions about how the fund would be spent. The following list identifies the responsibilities and duties of the housing board. 1, accept and review applications. to maintain eligibility priority list, annually certify and recertify applicants. 3, establish lottery procedures for selecting applicants to that have equal priority. 4, assist town board / planning board in determining and reviewing applications to build workforce housing units. 5, recommend annual maximum income limits, rental prices, resale values. 6, review certification from owners and lessors of rental units, certifying that units are occupied by eligible families. 7, maintain list of all workforce housing units in the town. 8, review all deed restrictions to workforce housing units. 9, review all lease terms for workforce housing units. And 10, promulgate rules and regulations as necessary.
Now, members of the housing board and the town board worked with Dutchess County Planning to come up with some numbers that would be relevant to this law.
Right. And before I get into what, you know, some of my particular questions in drafting the law are, another concern is when these payments are going to be received by the town. And in subsection K of the workforce housing law, part of it provides, in any phased development, such conditions shall also establish a phasing schedule to ensure that any required workforce housing units are built or fees in lieu of building such units are paid on a pro rata basis as the development is built out. And if you look at subsection C, it gives the schedule for a project that would be built in phases. And, you know, this is important for the board to consider because the market rate units, which are the units that the developer is building, you know, for just regular sales, if he builds up to 25% of the units, they do not have to build workforce housing at that point. When they have 25% of the units plus one, they have to build at least 10% of the workforce housing units. 50% of the market rate units, then they'd have to have 50% of the workforce housing units built, and then 75%, 75%, and then 100% of the workforce housing. One concern that I have is that, you know, you have to consider the percentage of build that, let's say they build the, let's say they're at 25% plus one unit. They actually have to get certificates of occupancy for those units before they are mandated to build the workforce housing, or if they choose to do the fee in lieu of, to pay the fee. So you could look at a situation where if they've built a number of homes and they're slow in selling, the real estate market is slow, they may not try to get the CO right away, mm-hmm. and meanwhile the town would be sitting, you know, waiting for, could be either your workforce housing units or the fee in lieu of. So there is a phasing schedule that pushes your receipt of the fees in lieu of out, but you would be in the same situation if they were actually building the workforce houses. But you could be looking at a significant delay.
But, I mean, is there any real rush to get the workforce housing or the fee in lieu of?
Well,
I don't see the problem with having a delay to see how the units go. I think the staged process makes sense. I mean,
well, the problem is that according to the zoning law, the town will not be able to except in lieu of, unless we have a local law in place.
Well, we do need to get that in place.
But that's just
that's the
in
point.
Lieu of portion
yes.
of it.
Yes.
I think I would be in favor of getting this law in place so that Silo Ridge or any other applicant who wants to, chooses to go that route and is capable of, you know, has the project that meets those criteria, we would have that moving forward.
Okay, but to have the fee in lieu of section doesn't mean that we have to have all of the housing application processing portions in place.
I think the law probably laid out.
Well, there were resolutions passed back in 2008. The second of which is dated December 11, 2008, where the town board actually adopted the executive regulations as the town's program for administering the provisions of the workforce housing law. I need to get those. That's the first thing, because I need to see what's in there in drafting the law. And the town certified that the town is prepared to administer the provisions of the workforce housing law pursuant to the executive regulations adopted. And these were the preliminary steps that were required.
Well, those are
to be
in place.
Taken.
I think
those are in
I
place.
Think what we're looking at when we put this local law in place was whether or not we're going, you know, because we have to put the amount that we've been presented in it, but also whether to put a time.
Well, that's the tricky part, is the analysis was done by Dutchess County Planning to come up with the fees that are relevant in the current market, you know, looking at interest rates, mortgage rates, and real estate prices. So they've come up with those, you know, fees for, I think it's what, the two bedroom and then the three plus bedrooms. So they have that currently, but I think in the local law, you would want to put a provision, and I've started drafting it, and what I'm proposing to put in is the town board reserves the right to review and to adjust the fee to be paid as an alternative to the construction of workforce housing on at least an annual basis. It doesn't mean you have to do it every year, but it gives the option to do it if things were to change quickly and, let's say, prices went up and mortgage rates went up. It would give you the option of doing that. The awkward part, the way the zoning law is drafted, is that it says you have to do it by local law. Some towns have done it by resolution. So,
wasn't there, because I read through this, wasn't there a section in there that said that all of the parts, basically all the parts that pertain to money, the median income, and the price of real estate and building costs and everything had to be reviewed annually by the board, by resolution?
I don't know what section you're referring to, but I think that's different than the town setting the fee in lieu of. Like the requirements
that's
of a person to qualify.
That's like all of the monetary parts that add up to what would be the fee in lieu of had to be set annually. And then
it's an analysis. That's what county planning. I think you're talking about provisions for a person to qualify, like income, you know, what income they have to have in order to qualify to get one of the workforce housing units. I mean, county planning in conjunction with Hudson River Housing has performed the analysis under the current market conditions, but that doesn't mean it's going to be good next year or 5 years from now. And I think the other tricky part, when you have a development that is going to be built out over a longer period of time, and you may not be able to predict, let's just say the Silo Ridge project, you may not be able to predict how quickly the homes are going to sell, how many years it will take to do the build out. So that if you set the fees now and a developer elects to do that, personally, I don't think you would want to tie yourself into the current rate that county planning came up with. If there are some units that are going to be built 10 years from now and you will not get the payment until year 10 or year 8,
you know.
So I think you add in that provision that you suggested, which says we have the option of renewing it. If it happens next year and nothing has changed dramatically in all of those factors.
Yeah, it stays the same.
We stay the same. Otherwise, we enact a local law. I'm perfectly comfortable with that.
Our amendment.
Okay.
Yeah.
But option, not requirement.
But we want...
Option, not requirement.
An option to to review the price.
So the local law would establish... Let me just ask Sue. You don't have any kind of a fund already set up? So this would authorize the creation of the Workforce Housing Trust Fund. Would be a segregated municipal fund controlled by, and this is again language that has to be determined, is it going to be controlled by the town board with the direction and oversight of the housing board?
I would say
you know,
yes.
And I'm trying to look at the language in the zoning law and...
I would prefer it that way. You know, the town board, and I think, you know, it should rest with us as far as, you know, and of course we would work in tandem with the housing.
You know, because I think we have, if you look at subsection L of the zoning, the town board shall appoint the housing board, which shall administer the workforce housing program, you know, and they do enumerate the duties. I don't see anything specifically on the funds, but I think it's pretty clear that, you know, the...
But if you look at the section four where it's basically assist the town board and planning board, then I think it kind of clearly indicates that the town board would be the overseeing.
Well, it says also the town board can contract with the county or other nonprofit organization, et cetera, to administer all or a portion of the workforce housing program under the direction and oversight of the housing board. So that's the question on that language there, which
I think we do need some assistance from. Mary Ling has been very helpful and has worked with other towns to do that. Our housing board, comprised of local citizens, can help with criteria and helping to oversee it, but I think we need the services of a professional, either the Dutchess County Planning and Development, Ann Saylor, or Mary Ling of Hudson River Housing. These people know how to manage this.
Well, they're all part of the resolution that we passed in 2008.
That they will be a part of this.
That they will be a part of this. So we already have the resolution in place. Because there was also the Dyson Foundation was also part of that resolution.
Okay.
So that is everyone comfortable with Denise going ahead and drafting the local law?
Yes. I think it should be run by Mary Ling and Ann Saylor
because I think that's
they
a good idea.
Are familiar with this process.
Right.
Okay.
The other question I had is whether or not, let me just find this section. In regard to the fund, once you would receive funds on the fees in lieu of, the Workforce Housing Trust Fund shall be used exclusively to provide for the acquisition, planning, construction, improvement, sale or resale, subsidy, or other legal means of creating more workforce housing for income-qualified households within the town. And this is a question I have, whether you want to include this. And the reason is because in subsection P, the mandatory workforce housing, one of the options for a developer is to make a substantial contribution toward the cost of providing water and sewer infrastructure to the hamlet of Amenia or Wasaic. So the question is, do you want to put that in as a permitted application of the funds. It would be like, or to make improvements to water and or sewer infrastructure to the hamlets of Amenia or Wasaic, and this is also language from the workforce housing law, provided the town board and the housing board shall determine that such contribution to such infrastructure substantially advances the town's goals of increasing the availability of housing for the persons who are the intended beneficiaries of the workforce housing program as described in zoning law section 12142. And again, that's specific language.
So we don't.
You do.
Yes, okay. That is exactly what it was intended.
Doesn't seem that way.
To specifically designate it for that?
That was the heart and soul of this whole rezoning for Silo Ridge, was that by providing them the opportunity to build the density of houses on Delavern Hill, that we would have this one-time opportunity to provide a fee that would help build a sewer system for the town of Amenia that has been recognized for 60 years as being a necessary improvement for low income housing. This is one way of providing the density to the hamlet that is needed to keep costs affordable for our citizens to stay here.
And then there's a provision, in no event shall monies deposited in the Workforce Housing Trust Fund be transferred to any other account unless such transfer shall be determined by the town board after consultation with the housing board to be in furtherance of the workforce housing goals of the town as set forth in the zoning law. And again, I can do a draft and, you know,
draft,
just,
send
and
it out.
You can look at it.
I'm just not understanding one thing, because if they're doing the pay in section P, subsection 2, so they say, you know, you can, you have a couple of ways you can do this. You can A, pay a fee, B, build the houses, C, place a restrictive covenant, or D, make a contribution that is going to go to water and sewage. So, I mean, I'm just not seeing how it is and. I'm reading this as or. I don't see how it's.
It's not.
They're
and.
All options, all individual options.
But it gives them individual options. So if we put money into a workforce housing account to ensure that people have affordable housing in our community, you know, that the purpose of the funds there are for those houses to be maintained and built up as the years go by, then somebody could come in and raid that account.
But this section said that part of the affordable housing, making housing affordable, is for water and sewer infrastructure.
Yeah, if you're going to have
satisfy that.
That's, you know,
an or, not
goal.
And.
She read another section.
Part of it, if we're looking at workforce housing, and you're going to be clustering homes, and having the density bonus, you know, all of that, all of the refuse from those septic systems and the water supply need to go somewhere. So you need to kind of have it in tandem with water and sewer. So I can totally understand where that fits, because you're going to be thinking about the people that are going to be staying in those houses, and you're going to definitely want to be able to, we're looking toward the future growth of the community.
Right.
So you want to be able to have a mechanism in place to put in sewer and water and doing it. It doesn't just talk about the way in which we're going to do that, the method, because right now the wastewater committee is talking about a certain method of treating sewer water and the solids and all. It doesn't go into that detail, but it provides the mechanism in order to provide the funding in order to, if we do go down that road, we'll be able to have that safety net, so to speak. Am I correct?
Yes, and I also think if the decision is made, and you know, it said it would be in consultation with the housing board, that you need to do the improvements or expansion to water or sewer, you know, that in and of itself may make those homes, I think you made the point, Vicki, those homes in that area more affordable.
That's right.
Because if someone has to pay for revamping a system or improving it or expanding it and the taxes go up, that again impacts the person trying to buy that house.
But it just seemed to me that it outlined a way to make sure that funding was safe and secured for the actual housing itself. And you know, it's like it's an or versus an and. Section P, subsection 2.
Well, I don't think it's excluded, but it's not my decision. It's the board's decision. I mean, it's not my, this is not my decision how this gets set up or administered.
No, I mean how it's outlined and written.
What are you looking at?
In the zoning code, section P, subsection 2.
Well, one of the options is they can make, quote, a substantial contribution. And again, there's no specific amount set forth there, so that's would have to
right.
be determined. But but
my question, which I'm just not understanding probably, is that something that stands alone as an option, or is it in conjunction with an option? You know, is it a standalone contribution? I want to give it to water, or I want to give it to making sure that, you know, those houses can be standing 20 years, or I want to build sidewalks or whatever I want to do with it, or is it an and? I can, if I have money in the housing fund and I have infrastructure repairs that need to be done, like, you know, water, sewer, sidewalk, I could move money from one to the other.
I think it's a decision that the town board has to make about applying the fees for workforce housing. You know, there are different ways of fulfilling it, and it's up to the town board by local law to set this up, to determine a fee. And again, it's not my decision. I mean, it's up to the town board.
I'm in favor of leaving all of the options set forth previously intact, so that if there is a chance to build the sewer system and the fees in lieu could be enough to actually help tip the scales to make it affordable for people to live here and stay here, that's what we use the money for. It could be accrued over time. It doesn't require us to instantaneously turn on a dime and use our X number of dollars to build a sewer system. It does not corner us into that. It allows us to accrue that money over time to decide at some point in time, we're losing all our teachers, we're losing all our firemen, how can we best solve that issue? We could either build it ourselves, we could invite a contractor to come in and we can assist them with this fee to help them build the affordable housing. The intent is to make sure that we have a diversified population here, such as we currently now enjoy. We are not chasing anybody out by building a sewer system that people can't afford, and that we're trying alternative sources of income that developers can contribute to a fund that has the flexibility to leave us some open doors to solve the affordable housing issue that we see in Amenia and Dutchess County as a whole.
I think that's the key word that I'm trying to get across, Vicki, is I want to make sure that
our
we do have flexibility. And the way that I'm reading it is that we would not have the flexibility. They would have to like pre-choose and say, I want it to go to the housing, I want it to go to this, I want it to, and you can't mix.
I think we want to make sure that the language we choose
preserves those options.
That's why I'm trying
to be so clear about it,
okay.
And make sure I understand.
Yep.
Because we could end up boxing
Other
ourselves
communities
in where we don't want to be.
Have done this, and we have John Nolan at Pace University Law School, who actually was the one who created these laws, is available for free advice. He's the guy who made these cutting edge laws that are offering towns now these flexibility. I would absolutely consult him to make sure that he has some model laws that we could follow that do not box us into a corner that we didn't intend. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And I'd be happy to call him to see if he wouldn't be available for one of his assistants to help us with crafting this law.
I have a book, too, that was written by him, that first meeting that we went to in Pine Plains,
mm-hmm.
and they handed out the book with the different laws and everything else. I still have that book. I'll let you look at that, Denise.
Okay. And the other provision that can be in here is that the town board may require the posting of a financial guarantee to ensure payments required as an alternative to the construction of workforce housing. Sort of like a bond, you know, that you would have for a development, which, you know, I think is probably a very good idea, because since the payments are pushed out in a phasing schedule, it gives you some assurance if the projects should go under, which has happened frequently. So I think that's a good idea, and it says that you may require it. So I think that would be a good provision to put in.
But if the project goes under, you're not building the houses, so you don't have the 10% of the workforce housing.
Well, but what I'm saying is, in other words, if they had to build, if they built like 50% and you had your schedule,
mm-hmm.
that now they're supposed to give you the 50% and you don't get it because now they go under and they're out of town. They leave town. Yeah. So I don't know if Sue had anything she wanted to add, thoughts. I don't know if they've discussed some of these things.
One thing I had, and we had spoken about this, is, you know, how are you going to determine 8 years from now? I mean, it could work against us if we have to revisit, you know, what if interest rates go down to 2%? So, I mean, I think we have to think long and hard. You know, I think for people to move forward, you know, we need to deal with today. And Ann Saylor went out a year and estimated, you know, because she even said there's no way you're going to know. So, I mean, I think if we talk about a schedule, you know, do we say 6 years, 25%, 50%, 75%, 100%? I mean, I think it's unfair to say we're going to revisit this if interest rates go up to protect ourselves. We're trying to get this done today and, you know, get things moving on both parts, the developer's parts, whether it's Silo Ridge or another developer, and the town. And the other thing is the fee in lieu of, I know, Gretchen, your concern is, you know, sidewalk repair, et cetera. Well, another thing that Ann Saylor had discussed is, you have that fee in a trust fund overseen by the housing board and the town board, and you can buy a house with that.
Right.
You know, and you
could
you could fix it up. And
right.
It doesn't, you know, it doesn't have to be for wastewater. It can be to buy a piece of property, a piece of land, and build a house, and, you know,
we'll,
then
we'll renovate one.
Yeah, exactly. And
like
so
Habitat does.
Yeah, and I think that if we get going and get moving forward and get this done and operate like it's today and not look 8 years down the road and let everybody get to work, that it's going to benefit everybody. You know, there's pieces of property that could be purchased by, you know, say they build out 25%. You know, so I think if we want to be fair to everybody, but we want to get going, and I think it's time to get going, and, you know.
So we need to get it in place.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't want to get caught up in 6 months from now, we revisit the same thing. It's not fair, and it's tiring, and it's time to go forward, and, you know, it doesn't matter if it's Silo Ridge or someone else. It costs money to do this. So it costs money for Denise to do this.
We need to start moving forward on this, is what
yeah,
you're saying.
I agree. I mean,
I agree with you.
I think that if everybody works together on it, we can get it done. And you know,
great.
But I don't know if anybody's got any more questions. That
so you feel Ann Saylor did a great job coming up with some numbers based on the best projections she could come up with,
right.
And she recommends going with.
She does, and I,
okay.
You know, she said a lot of it is subjective,
right.
And she, you know, you want to interject your personal opinions, knowing places, but she didn't do that.
Right.
You know, she did a lot of work with numbers, and, you know, as far as the 25%, 50%, the time frame, that's right in there. You know, that's in the memo that Silo Ridge prepared, and that's, I mean, I agree with that. I mean, I think it's time to get going. And I think the number, 536,000, is a reasonable number. You know, but that's my opinion.
Okay.
I think it's workable. But I think we should really move forward. It's time to go ahead, because it can only benefit everybody, or the whole town.
Well, why don't we plan to go ahead and go forward?
I've already started drafting it.
With a draft and with the goal of presenting it at the July meeting.
Okay.
Sounds good to me.
The other question I had, and Ann Saylor raised this, she recommended there be a provision with respect to administrative fees that they not exceed, she threw out a number of 10%, but you know, that would be something I think that you would want to consider. Obviously, it depends on the amount. You know, 10% of a large amount can be a big fee. 10% of a smaller amount might not seem so much as an administrative fee. So that's another thing that she recommended be put in here. So I would need your thoughts on the percentage or amounts.
So the administrative fee for administering the fund?
Fund.
And who would that go to, towards Ann Saylor's part or Mary Ling's part in helping the town administer this? Is this what you're...
I guess it would depend who might be lending assistance to the town, or whether the housing committee or the housing board is going to do it.
So in other words, a portion of the $500,000 we would get from theoretically Silo Ridge, a portion of that could be set aside for administration. I don't see any problem with that, because you have accounting fees. You do have to hire a lawyer now and then to help you. It wouldn't hurt for us to say an allowable use of that funds could be up to 10%.
And I like the cap of 10% on it, because I've heard so many horror stories where they put the fund in, and the next thing you know, 90% is going to one guy sitting and smoking cigars somewhere.
Yeah.
So it'd be not to exceed 10%.
Right. Yeah. Something like that.
By project or by total amount?
Well, that
funds?
Would be, yeah, that would be the question.
I would think total amount
in
of
the
fund?
In the fee, in the fund. In other words, if you get several $500,000 amounts and you have $1 million in that account, you could use 10% to hire, you know, to provide the legal and accounting and whatever else assistance. I mean, it'd be like a grant.
Yeah, I think it should be across the board.
Yeah, whatever you've got in the fund, no more than 10% is allowable for administrative purposes, right? That's a typical grant, for instance.
So is it going to be 10% of the amount taken in for Project A, or is it going to be, you know, how would you do that on an ongoing basis? You have money in the fund, and maybe you have more monies coming in.
Maybe per project would be
10%. I would think 10% of the overall fund, period. Whatever is in the fund.
But how are you going to
per annum?
That?
Per annum?
Per year?
Mm-hmm. In other words, each year you have an accounting, and you say, "Well, I had to spend 5% on legal fees, and we needed an appraisal. That was another, you know, 1%, and the accounting this year was a 3% chunk, but we can't exceed the 10%. In other words, per annum, can't exceed 10% per annum of the total fee.
Okay. Is there any other questions or discussion?
We're good. So next meeting we'll go over the draft of it.
No, you'll get the draft before the next meeting. And then you can just give Denise your comments.
Okay. So I'll send you out something next week. Try to do it in the early part of the week. Which
yeah, so everybody can look at
give
it.
Give some time.
Mm-hmm. highway garage update. We currently have a plan for what we want the highway garage to look like, but we haven't decided where exactly we want to build it. We're looking at different parcels of land. We're trying to look at the absolute best place to build the highway garage, where there's good soil and there's plenty of land for a highway garage and hopefully a salt shed. There have been no decisions made about buying any particular property. We're still in looking mode to look at any and all possible places for the highway garage. We did look at, there's property near the highway garage. We've looked at the property that the fire department owns. We're not even sure if they, if they're ready to sell it or not. Just to try to see what's out there and what might be a good place for the highway garage. This is going to be a substantial cost to the town. The cost may have to be purchase of land. We did have a donation given to us several years ago for $5,000. That amount is now $6,611, maybe a little bit more with interest, for a highway garage, so we can use that money for appraisal or surveys. But there haven't been any decisions made. We're just in looking mode right now, trying to come up with the best possible place for our highway garage. Trail to the train update. I asked to meet with Carol and Ryan, who from the DOT, so far, so we can go over the preliminary design. Currently, I've sent a letter of intent and statement of donation and other documents to the property owner where the trail to the train will be going through. The property owner has requested that we change the language in the documents from easement to donation because he wants to gift the land to the town. This means that the town will will have to pay for an appraisal somewhere along the line. And we'll
now the right gift, we have to pay for an appraisal of the property?
Well, as a municipality, we would have to have an appraisal. Even for any money
for a
we're
gift?
Giving. Yes. So, that's something we're, working on the language right now. I spoke with him this week, so we can go ahead. What we're working on, Metro North is going to give the town a permanent easement for the trail to the train. They do want us to pay for the appraisal of the land. I don't have the dollar amount of what that will be yet because it's still going through all the parts of Metro North. It has to go through several departments and it has to go through their board of directors to get, to get everything finalized. The survey that was done of the land is being looked at Metro North. There was a slight problem with the survey, and they will be correcting whatever that problem was with the survey.
Who did the survey?
They had it done.
Metro North.
Yeah, Metro
okay.
North had someone
okay.
had do the survey. So we're still, we're in that process of the right-of-way agreements for Metro North and for the property owner.
Now, isn't there a list of acceptable appraisers
that the state would accept? In other words, is you just don't get anybody to come out and appraise it. Perhaps Metro North has its own list of appraisers.
They have their own list of appraisers.
That we would have to choose and then hire, or they would hire it and we pay for it.
Actually, it's done independently. Nowadays, it's done independently because, you know,
we have to pay for it.
Yeah, we would have to pay for it.
It just seems like we could get started on the process if it were possible to move it along.
No, they're taking care of it. They're taking care of it. And we're also working with the DEC and getting through that piece of it too, through the wildlife.
Fish and wildlife?
Yeah. So everything's in process. It's taking a long time. I did speak to Carolyn Ryan and asked for a meeting with Mike Haggerty and I and WSP Sells so that we could go over where we are to date and to request an extension of the grant, because there's no way we're going to be able to start construction this year. We wouldn't be able to start construction until next year. But she, when I spoke to her, she said as this type of grant goes, she thought we were pretty much where she expected us to be, and she thought we were doing pretty well. She's seen other federal grants that are as complex or more complex as this, that, you know, that go on for a lot longer length of time. So we're getting there.
A lot of government agencies you have to go through.
Public comment?
Once again, if I may. I notice you're spending this money that you're getting for workforce housing before you get it.
We're not spending anything. What are you talking about? We don't have it.
You're talking about spending it without before you even get it, and building a sewer plant and a water system with this money and the rest of the town and the other hamlets are not getting a dime out of this. So isn't it a little odd that 10% of the revenue that is collected within the town, the 90% is outside the town, and yet you're not considering it. And
I'm not sure what you're talking about. We're establishing a fund to put the money in.
And then you're projecting to use it for a sewer plant and water. Is it not true?
Sewer or water?
Okay.
To make housing
that was
affordable.
The original plan for this whole damn thing was that we tie into Silo Ridge's system.
Well, that was the original thought, but yeah. That offer has been
That would have
changed.
Been great. But now nobody needs a sewer system more than Passaic. Nobody.
I would agree.
And yet they're not even being considered. So shouldn't you at least ask the rest of the voters to have some input in what you might do with this money?
Well, it would be spelled out in this law. And so that's what we're trying to figure out now, is to put in the language of the law to make it clear what it is that we are accepting this money to be used for and how it would be administered.
Okay, well.
So you will have a chance for input. A local law has
plenty of
opportunities.
We'll
have a
public hearing.
I just want to divide it up a little bit to be considered.
Okay.
We're not
well,
at that
part
point
of
yet.
The local law is to have a public hearing, so there'll be a public hearing.
Okay. Now, you were talking about the trail that Mike's been involved in for quite some time. I understand that you've already spent $90,000 and you haven't turned a spade of dirt over yet. Have you or haven't you?
Design fees.
That's for the design.
Okay. All I'm saying is...
You're right. We haven't turned a spade of dirt. Not at all.
Okay. Those are issues also. Most of the people are opposed to this trail to the train. But yet we're going ahead with it. But I saw Molinaro build a stadium that the people didn't want either. So things can be done.
Well, this grant was signed for by a former supervisor, and it was presented to the town, and...
No, I'm just saying, consider this deeper than just...
We received $487,000 grant, and
well,
it takes time.
Okay, it's taking time. I just want to make sure that you get your dollars worth. I'm a little on the cheap side.
But you're also dealing with the bureaucratic mentality, too, when it comes to the agencies that, in administering and trying to get this grant and push it along, we've had to go through. You're talking about the MTA. You're talking about all sorts of government agencies that they've had to go through it step by step. And, you know, sometimes they don't move pretty fast.
Well, these same things that you're referring to are going to be there as the project goes forward, if it goes forward. All right, thank you.
I believe I skipped over the Old Amenia landfill update. I apologize, I didn't mean to do that. We had a special meeting last Thursday. We were asked to do a change order in the amount of $100,955.68. And the change order was to address erosion problems at the Old Amenia landfill site. And what the money was for is to create a articulating concrete block system for permanent stabilization in the steeper portions of the north drainage swale. Because of high intensity rainstorms and the grass not being established, we need additional stabilization of the north drain of the north site. So that's the purpose of the articulated concrete block system for the steeper slopes. One of the problems that have been at the Old Amenia landfill site is the lack of vegetative ground cover. The type seed mix that was used, we call native steep slope mix, is more wildflowers and grasses that can take up to 2 to 3 years to be established. In the areas where a base bed mix that consists of clover, fescue, and rye, you know, has had a better cover. Now, what the contractor is doing, the other problem was that the contractor seeded outside of the recommended time limit for seeding some of the grass mix in October and November, and the contractor is responsible for reseeding those areas that were seeded outside of the recommended time. The contractor is also responsible for silt fence and swales and anything that is needed to take care of the erosion problems that have plagued the site. I've been there twice this week, and I've been pretty much there, you know, at least once a week, twice a week. I've met with the DEC, I've met with the contractor,
with Liz Rovers, who's the project manager for CTMail, looking for solutions to the problems down there, and this was one of the solutions. Another solution is also going to be to add a sideline channel to help corral some of the water from the erosion. So it's an ongoing process. It's a complicated issue due to multiple problems between lack of vegetative cover in some of the areas and also erosion because of the lack of vegetated covers, and also for the fact that we did have some very intense rainstorms that caused a lot of problems and kept some of the vegetated cover from actually growing the way it should. It's continuing to monitor it with Kimberly Ray, who is our original attorney for the Old Amenia landfill, and working and meeting with Liz Rover's project manager to see what we need to go forward. Another problem that happened along the pond is that there were plantings and shrubs that should have been planted in the spring that will now be planted by a subcontractor in the fall, where September is the correct planting time for those particular plantings and shrubs. So they were supposed to finish last month. That's not going to happen. They will be back in 2 weeks to do some mowing. Next week they are going to be paving the area from the road into the Old Amenia landfill. I was down there with the DOT the other day, and Chuck Walter from the DOT, and watching them go through the process of what they needed to do with that. I also met with the person, the head of the seed company, to talk about the different type seeds that were planted. It's very complex problem. We're looking at it, working with the contractor, working with the project manager, and seeing what we need going forward to address not only the erosion problems, which are pretty well taken care of with the silt fence that has been put up, and the use of sod and now the articulating block in place of using rock. But it's, it's an ongoing process. They're coming back in 2 weeks to mow, and they will be doing additional plantings. We're looking at any areas that may need to be hydro-seeded to get more of a vegetated growth to address the erosion. Anything that was planted, any grass that was planted outside the recommended seeding time, either in the spring or in the fall, the contractor is responsible for. The DEC, they have been told by the town, when I have met with them and the DEC, that they will not be reimbursed for anything that they planted during the wrong planting times. They've also, at their own expense, added fertilizer over the whole site. So we're working on the problems as we go along to try with the ultimate goal of getting a vegetated cover over the whole site, which the contractor is responsible for doing. Town board comments?
The Garden Club of Amenia is having the Hidden Garden Tours on Saturday, July 12th from 10 to 4. You can get tickets online at ameniagardens.com, or you can pick up your tickets at the Four Brothers parking lot on Saturday, July 12th. There'll be a booth there. And of course, on Friday, July 11th, we're going to have our Meet the Gardeners Wine and Cheese, which is a free event. You can come out to, this year it'll be on Lake Amenia Road, Jade Hill Garden, and come on out and meet the gardeners and take a look at one of the gardens, and it should be a lovely event. The proceeds, of course, go to purchasing bulbs and other plants, which are then given away in October for free to all residents of all the hamlets of Amenia. So hopefully you can make it on July 11th from 5 to 7 on Lake Amenia Road, or on July 12th from 10 to 4. You can pick up tickets again at Four Brothers Restaurant. It'll be a perfect follow-up after you spend next week at the Fireman's Carnival. So the week after, you can go to gardens. It'll be fun. That's all I have.
Any other town board comments?
I got a couple. The first thing about Mr. Collins' comments that he had, I do agree that there is some issues going on in town. I would like to, you know, if he's watching, lend a handout to him to sit down and talk with him personally about it. But I do agree that there are some merits to some of his issues. Again, the trees that were planted last year, there's a couple across the street from my place. The tops of them are all dead and stuff like that. So I do want to, you know, put an invitation out to him to stop by and talk to me, email me, call me, whatever he wants to do. I would like to help him and get some of these issues taken care of. Another comment I have, I guess it's kind of a question. Do we have anybody on the town payroll or accountant or anything like that to ask advice about our money issues? Like, is it better for us to build a town garage opposed to renting one or leasing one? Is it better for us to purchase something instead of renting it? I mean, do we have some kind of financial consultant or anything like that?
We don't have a financial advisor. We could get a financial. If there's someone recommended, but you mean as looking at the highway garage as to?
I mean, money issues in general. I mean, it looks like we have a lot of money issues coming up, and you know, in lieu of fees and this fee and that fee and everything else. I mean, it's a lot of money. Do we have professionals to advise us on, should it be in a CD? Should it be in a trust fund? Should it be here? Should it be there? And when we do spend our money.
Actually, we have a municipal accountant.
Municipal accountant?
Yes.
But now, is that a financial advisor?
No, but we can, you know, if we need a financial advisor, we can hire a financial advisor.
Okay. CTOR and company has done very well at giving us some long-range forecasts, sitting down with the board. Bill brought them in, and we went over the pros and cons of getting a loan for loan for some of the highway equipment, or whether we, you know, how we should be planning for the next big expenditures that are coming down the road. It's not inexpensive, but it was extremely helpful to have a special town board meeting that went over the long-range financial planning for the town.
Okay. I guess that, you know, but I mean, do you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, it's very helpful.
You know, it's very just, we have a lot of big decisions, and we have a lot of money. We have a lot of, you know, a lot of people are counting on us to make the right decisions. And I just wanted to, do we have it at our means?
We have good advice.
Beautiful.
If, when, you know, and I'm sure Victoria will help us. And that reminds me, if I may, ask about the deadline for getting committees and board department heads their budget together so that we can already start forecasting for 2015. Because
usually the forms go out in August.
So it'll be August deadline?
No, you'll get the forms in August. The deadline will be in September.
September 1, okay. I would also ask that the town board members, before they leave tonight, tell me whether or not they're available for a peaceful dedication ceremony at Beekman Park on either July 19th or July 26th, and I'm proposing 10 a.m. Those dates are appropriate for the Westlake Peace Sanctuary. Their executive director will be here for those two dates, so I could be here for the July 26th, but not the 19th. So. Before you leave, make sure I write down what your availability is. Mike, I've got you on both times as being a possibility.
Yeah. I'm both.
And you're both, and so is...
The 26th and 19th, I'm not available for either of those dates.
Oh, no,
the 12th.
Stephen. Oh, okay. Okay. So Victoria. And Victoria. And can you ask Chris Klinger also as being... Chris, are you available either July 19th or 26th or both? 10 a.m. at Beekman Park. Okay. It's a Saturday morning at Beekman Park. Okay, and then.
Are you available either day? I don't know. I'll have to check.
Check, and you'll come back.
Yeah, I've looked at my calendar. I can move things around, but I need to check. You know, my better half.
Okay. Okay. And then August 1st through the 3rd is the Wasaic Project Festival, and their summer festival is excellent. Their exhibit is fabulous, and their Friday night of the August 1, 2, and 3 that really starts the whole project off is excellent. The dance productions that they bring to that opening night is phenomenal. So I would encourage everybody to try and get out there over the weekend and over the summer. There are open hours for the gallery. It is 8 floors of amazing artwork, and it gets better every year. And this is by far, I was just blown away with this year's exhibits. Very interesting. And July 12th and 19th minutes, do you want us to, is everybody ready to approve them? No, you did a great job, Dawn Marie. You're on top of them, so stay on top of them. I make a motion that we approve the July 12th and 19th, 2014 minutes.
I'll second that.
Councilman DeLango?
Yes.
Councilwoman Hitzelberger?
Was I here for both of those?
You were here for the 12th, not the 19th.
Then I cannot vote.
So, no. Councilwoman Doyle?
Yes.
Councilman Brody?
Yes.
And Councilwoman Supervisor Brody?
Yes. The Brodies get you tongue-tied.
I know you get
tongue-tied. And that's all I have.
Thank you. Any other town board comments? No? Supervisors report. I received a letter on June 17th. Dear Supervisor Perotti, on behalf of the students' administration at Weebatuck High School, I would like to send our most sincere appreciation to you and everyone who facilitated the use of the Town of Amenia baseball field this past spring. It was a major help to all three of our baseball teams. We are very thankful that we were able to work together so well. Please pass along our appreciation to all involved. We look forward to working together in the future. Sincerely, John Zenz, Athletic Director, Weebatuck High School. Baseball closing ceremonies are on Friday, June 27th at 4:30. So anybody, you know, should code and see how well all our teams did. And the Amenia Fireman's Carnival is July 2nd through July 5th. Fireworks are on Friday, July 4th, and the parade is on Saturday, July 5th. This is a very big event this year because the Amenia Fire Company are hosting the county convention, so we're expecting a lot of visitors. The senior bus trip to Best Western Inn at Hunt's Landing is July 9, 2014. A day of fun-filled day of activity, shopping, and more. There will be a country western band, bingo, themed luncheon, live entertainment. Call Frankie O'Connell at 373-9693 or mail check to Evelyn O'Connell, Post Office Box 96, Amenia, New York, 12501.
or call Charlene Pollinger at 373-9650 or mail check to Charlene Pollinger, 393 Route 22, Wasaic, New York. It's $34 a person. Send check or money order only by July 1st and make out your check or money order to the town of Amenia. And the bus is sponsored by Amenia Recreation. The town of Amenia annual senior chicken barbecue for age 55 and older is August 9th, 2014, 11:30 a.m. at the Wasaic Firehouse. Call Orpah Thomas for reservations by July 24th at 845-877-0492. There is a limit of 140 people. And the Southern Berkshire Amateur Radio Club will be at the Amenia Fire Department Pavilion on June 28th and 29th, 2014, between 2 p.m. on Saturday and 10 a.m. on Sunday. This is the National Field Day event for amateur radio personnel, so stop by and pay them a visit. Amenia Day Camp has been having registration and sign-ups. It starts June 30th, 2014, will be held at the Amenia Town Hall. Camp will be closed Friday, July 4th. The last day of camp will be August 8th, 2004. Ages 5 to 13 must be entering kindergarten. The day camp will be 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And that's all I have. And I'd like to make a motion to come out of regular session and go into executive session to discuss pending litigation.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?